Sins here in the congregation, in the building, and there online. My question is, have you come to work this morning for the Lord? Are you ready to roll up your sleeves and do the work? But there's also some work today, too. After church, we're going to hang the greens, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Better part of it is, after we get done, there's pizza. So, on that note, I want to turn it over to Michelle. She has someone she wants everybody to meet.
Good morning. I want to introduce you to my friend here. Can you take the microphone? It's the red one. Can you tell everybody what your name is?
Daisy.
You say it really close.
Daisy.
Oh, this is my friend Daisy. Everybody say hi, Daisy. Okay, Daisy, so we have been talking about doing a special thing that you and your family came up with, right? So, does it have to do with a bake sale?
Yes.
And do you want to tell everybody what you want to do with that bake sale? Do you want to do, what you want to do with the money from the bake sale? What do you want to do with it? Do you want to buy goodies?
We're going to save up money from the bake sale. And give it to buy people Christmas presents.
Doesn't that sound awesome? So this is an idea that you and your brothers and your mom all came up with, and you talked to Miss Marcy about, right?
Yes.
And when did we decide to do this bake sale? Is it going to be Sunday, December 3rd?
Yes.
Yes. So what do you need the congregation to bring some goodies to donate for the bake sale, like yummy food?
Yes.
Do you think brownies are yummy food?
Yes.
Do you think cookies are yummy food?
Yes.
Do you think fudge is yummy food?
Yes.
So all those kinds, how about pies? Do you think pies would be a good yummy food to sell?
Yes.
Okay, so you would like the congregation to help bring yummy things for the bake sale. Do you think they should buy things at the bake sale?
Yes.
So do you think they should come with money in their pocket ready to buy yummy things to take home so that they can donate to the bake sale that way?
Yes.
Okay. So I think there's some other ways that you guys are seeing the great side. Other ways people could also donate ingredients, because I think there's going to be baking happening here at church on Saturday from 2 to 5. Is that right?
Yes.
So if you are inclined to bring goodies like sugar or eggs or melted, the stuff that you melt, the chocolate. Butter's good, too. Butter's good, too. So those kinds of items, and let me think. I think that's everything. So next Saturday, baking from 2 to 5 here, but you can also bake at home. And Sunday, December 3rd, a Christmas bake sale.
Yes.
After church. And it'll still be going on after Sunday school, because it's also open to the public, isn't it? We really want to invite others. So tell your friends about it who like to have Christmas goodies to come by after their church and or off of work. Just come on in, buy some bake sale goodies. And then we're going to work together to get some really nice toys and goodies for in your apartment complex? Is that who you're primarily going to gift presents to? She doesn't know. We're going to talk about that. We got a meeting this week for those fine details, but we just love that this has been their desire. Hey, do you ride the bus to come to church? And do you like coming on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights?
Yes.
Is there anything else you want to tell them about what you love about church, or anything else you want to tell them about the bake sale? Nope, she doesn't want to talk anymore. All right. Daisy, you did awesome. Can we give Daisy a round of applause? If you can go sit down upstairs. So if you guys feel inclined to donate items, to bake, to donate ingredients, definitely come with money in your pocket to support this cause. We're so proud of them for just really taking the lead on wanting to give back to the community they live in. So if you have any questions, grab me, Marcy, Rachel. We'd be happy to try to figure it out. Thank you.
All right. Continuing announcements, the widows will meet Tuesday at noon in the fellowship hall. Please bring a lunch, and entry will be through the kitchen door. You won't have to worry about having to ring the bell and trying to get someone to come to the side doors to let you in. And in case you haven't seen it, there are additions and corrections to the church directory. If you normally receive a copy of the newsletter by hard copy in the mail, they will be in that. So, and if you get the newsletter by email each week, please look at that and either copy them or download and print it at your house. But the corrections will be in the next newsletter that goes out. And I think that's it.
Good morning.
Morning.
As you can see by my message topic, we're going to talk about obedience today and the blessings that it brings. Well, part of something that the Lord wanted me to share with you right now is that obedience sometimes means changes happen. And the change that happened for me is that 2 months ago, when Pastor asked me if I'd fill in today for him, I had already had a message in mind, and not very long after that, God changed it. So just understand that Pastor and I, when we are going to share with you, especially him, because he does it kind of weekly and I just kind of fill in, there's a lot of prayer and time with the Lord that we spend in getting the message. And you may think to yourself, well, what does that have to do with me? I got news for you. It might not, but somebody needed to hear the words that were coming out of the speaker's mouth. So please understand that anybody that ever gets up in front of you to share music, to share a message, to share a prayer request, has spent some time and the Lord has revealed to them what they want to say. So I hope that you will receive what I share with you later this morning with open hearts and understand that if I get nervous, he changed it on me. And it's just one of those things that happens. We need to go with God. We need to let God be God. And sometimes we need to get out of the way. Amen? Amen? Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we give this morning to you. We welcome you into this, your church, Heavenly Father. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we ask for a blessing upon our morning together, that we go about your business and learn from your word. And then, Lord, give us the energy to decorate this beautiful building. We love you, Lord, so much. We praise you and we thank you. In his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand and rise and let's worship the Lord.
I'll sing about you, save my soul.
those three words, trust and obey. The other ones that come to mind is, what a friend we have in Jesus. He's always there for us when we need him. Looking at the joys and concerns this morning, Ray and Anita Kay are still in rehab and coming along. Janice Kellerson was discharged from the hospital in time to be home for Thanksgiving, and continue to keep her lifted up in prayer. Connie Adams, friend of Roseanne Cox, is in the hospital with knee problems. Cheryl Marvel had a back ablation last week, and it went reasonably well, but she is still in pain. If you've ever had back problems, you know how sometimes that can get you down mentally as well as physically. And keep Rex in your prayers this morning. He's going to have to get another shot in his back for arthritis because he used up his last one making noodles for everybody. He's a dedicated man. We need to keep him lifted up and keep him with us. So if there's no other concerns people want to bring forward to the congregation, let's assume an attitude of prayer and go to the Lord this morning. Father, what a joy it is to come into your house this morning. To know that here you are listening, hearing our hearts, sifting through the rushes of our minds at different things, knowing that we really just need to be quiet and listen to you, to give up those worries, fears, confusion about lunch, about getting the car fixed, rushing to the mall to get something for Christmas. If we stop and listen, you'll let us know what's the important thing. Like Mary at the feet of Jesus that evening, she was doing what was important. Help us to also find that peace and knowledge and connection with your Son, our Lord and Savior. We lift up this morning our friends and family who are hurting physically and mentally. We continue to ask travel mercies and blessings on family as they are in the process of going or will soon be leaving to return to their homes and abides at the moment. And pray that all will go well. And we lift up your nation and your people, Israel, Lord. That land is still continues to be in pain, violence. We thank you for the release of the hostages that have happened so far and pray that more will soon take place. And we pray for peace for Ukraine and other countries that find themselves at war at this time because people want to be free. And we thank you, Lord, that we know freedom. Our ancestors fought for it. But freedom isn't free because there is a price of eternal vigilance, both politically and spiritually, because so easily Satan can grab our minds and twist it and take us away from you if we do not stand watch, as Nehemiah and Ezekiel and Habakkuk call us to be on that watchman on the tower, on the wall. But it's our hearts that we have to be on the watch for. And we have the hope, guidance, and assurance through those words that your Son taught us those years ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you have not already done so, you can bring your offering up into the plates, or if you give online, whatever, for your generosity to this God's kingdom. We thank you, and the praise team is going to bring us First Things First.
the things that I have held dear, the vanities that whispered in my ear. What would I do if they all disappear? Riches and fame and all that they could buy, I've come to find they never satisfy. What would I gain if my soul's the prize? I don't want to love what the world loves. I don't want to chase what the world does. I only want you. I only want you. First things first, I seek your will, not my own. Surrender all my wants to you. To keep the first things first. To live your truth, walk your ways, set my eyes. Lord, I fix my face on you. All my desires.
Offering that we are giving to you, we know that we can't match nearly anything close to what you give to us. But please accept this gift as a small token of all that you mean to us. And please help us, Lord, to build your kingdom. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
This next song that we're going to do before the children's come for children's time, I just want to give a little background to it. Because I feel like, as always, God's timing just comes together in amazing ways that just kind of blows my mind. He's paying attention to every detail. In 2020, Rachel, Val, Marcy, and I, and others, went to Ghana with Micah 6:8. And if you remember 2020, it was kind of nuts. We had COVID, we had fear, we had really hard things. We had choices to make, and one of those choices we had to make was, are we going to Ghana or not? Because we'd been planning for it, we'd been fundraising for it. And then quarantines happened, rules happened, restricted travel happened. And this song was one that really gave us, like, in the sense of just, we don't have any control in this. God has to make it clear. It just kind of spoke to all of our hearts, like God made it clear. And we did go to Ghana. And the reason I'm saying this timing is so amazing, I picked this song when we were planning worship because I've been really wanting to do it for a long time and felt like with the message that God had given Cheryl, like this was timely. And now, just this week, the book that Rachel Hayden has written about Micah 6:8 story is now available to be purchased. And it's an amazing story. I'm only in chapter 5, but it is something that I think just reveals to us that in the mess of this world, God is always leading us. And so I just pray that for whatever you need to be led through, that this song will speak to you as well as the words that God has given Cheryl.
Thank you.
It is a wonderful thing to have the siblings and the mom and the cousins together. Amen? Thank you. If the children would like to come down, Dana has a message to share with you. Come on down.
Now they're coming. There's Nathaniel. There's come what? I don't know. Next week for sure. We're gonna decorate. So next week is Sunday school. Just for today, not hello, hello. So what are these? What are these?
They're tissues.
They're tissues for when, and you're snotty. Okay. No, they're tissues. Everett was right. So here's my question to begin with, and then we'll talk a little bit. Have you ever used God like a tissue? I know, there's a thought. Have you ever used God like a tissue? So, what? It's just to think about, and I'm going to give you the answer.
I know.
What?
If you sneeze, Jesus is in front of you.
Well, you're right there. Absolutely, Jared. Absolutely. But, school started and the weather's cooler. Has anyone had a cold this fall?
Partial.
Yeah, where your nose gets all runny and runny and nose gets slimy.
I had another one, it went away.
Oh my gosh. So, what do you do when your nose is all slimy? And hopefully we're getting there. I know some little people have to have someone else say, look at your nose.
You sneeze on God.
You do? And that's okay.
Because if you need a tissue, God's there.
Okay, yeah. So, when we're thinking about tissues, and pass this around and everybody gets one to take home. So, when your nose is all yucky, do you have all of a sudden, and this is a, let's not talk because I'm going to ask all these people, I like to get the congregation, all those people out there are called the congregation if you didn't know that. Hey, Jared, let's listen up. So, I'm going to ask the congregation a question. You got to be looking at them to see. Do you ever have a runny nose and you don't have a tissue and all of a sudden it gets so bad you got to make a run for it and grab something? Anybody, show your hands. Look at them. See? There is, for you at home, there is a large number of people that's like, oh my gosh, I got to make a run for it and get my tissue. Well, but do you carry your tissue with you everywhere you go? Yeah, so do you carry your tissue everywhere you go?
Yeah.
You do? You always have a tissue in your pocket? Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't pass it over there. Yeah. Boy, you've got the answer. So do we treat God like a tissue and make a mad dash? So if something bad happens or things aren't going well and you go, oh, Jesus, help me, Jesus. I need you, Jesus, now. And so that's kind of like treating him like a tissue when we don't have a tissue with us all the time. Do you have God with you all the time?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's always watching everybody.
He is absolutely. So there's scripture for this, both in the New and Old Testament. So in the book of Joshua, Joshua was really a cool man. And God, yes, it's a Bible. So Joshua was really cool, but this is what God told him. And we can listen and think, this is in the first chapter of Joshua. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. So wherever you go, it's great when you got a cold to carry tissues. Wait till I'm done, okay? Really great to carry tissues, but you know who's always with us?
God.
Yeah. And that's in the Old Testament. And then in the New Testament, we're told, and this is in the book of Matthew, and this is the last chapter, and he says, I'm with you always to the very end of the age. And that's Jesus, who we know Jesus is also God. Jesus is telling people, I'm always with you. So that's the tricky part. Because I know you are young and you think, some of these days, I'll get better at this, or some of these days I'll understand better, or, some of us are still saying that, some of these days I'll understand better, and some of these days I'll get better. But we've got to remember God is always with us, and we don't want to use him like just a tissue. And as very, very helpful as tissues are. Yep, you can open it whenever, when you take it back. And there's a way probably it shows. But, so listen up, to the final important thing. Is everybody listening? Are your ears open and your mouth closed? Okay, that's the way. Are your ears open and your mouth closed? I know, but let's finish up here. So you can go back to prayer and praise. Let's really work at using God, and I don't like the word using God, but we use him to comfort us and, all those things that God is. So you are not too young to start thinking about, wow, so you're on the playground, and what happens when someone does something you don't want them to do, Jared? What happens? You're on the playground and someone does something mean. There we go. Wow, that's it. Jared said that he would ask him to be nice because God loves him. So see, you are not too young to start thinking about God all the time and not using God just when it's like, help me, Jesus. And that's okay to do.
And I'm seven.
And that's okay to do, to say, help me, God, when you need him for an emergency. But let's work on it all the time. Well, you'll be going back to prayer and praise, and then you can. Well, let's talk about that later. Okay, we can talk about Legos later. Oh, okay. So we're going to pray now, and then you can go to prayer and praise, okay? Okay, so let's everybody repeat after me. Is everybody ready? Lord Jesus, we thank you for being available
for us to talk
to you,
always.
Help us to remember to call on you for everything that we say, that we think, and that we do. We pray all of this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, now you can walk back to prayer and praise. I don't have enough for everybody.
Thanks, Dana. All right, you need to be. How many times have you walked into church, you opened your bulletin, and you realized all the scripture Pastor Darren was going to share, and there was a lot, and you were like, ugh. I'm telling you, I've done it. And I'm telling you, when I type it, I'm like, dude, seriously? Oops. And then God's like, Cheryl Ann? I'm like, sorry. So, yes, you are seeing a lot of scripture here, some of which I'm going to summarize, because God said I could, and some I'll read. But I promise you, this word is fire, And God wants you to hear what I'm sharing with you. I can't express to you how much is flowing through me right now to share what he has. As I told you earlier, he changed it. I had another really kind of cool message to share. Maybe that's for another day, or maybe you'll never hear it. I don't know. But today we're going to talk about obedience bringing blessings. Now, when you think about the Bible, and you open that word, that mighty word up, and you look through it, you can think of a million people in there that were known for their obedience to God. So I could stand here for days and talk to you about all of them. But God asked me to share with you from the Old Testament. We're going to talk about Noah, Abraham, Joshua, and from the New Testament, Simon Peter and Levi, who was also known, and we better know him as Matthew. So let's look at Genesis chapter 6, verses 8 through 13. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. Does that sound familiar? God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, I am going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both them and the earth. So in verses 14 through 22, God describes to Noah in detail how to build that ark. Now I want to remind you, prior to him asking him and telling him to build the ark and how big and how wide and how tall and all those things, it had never rained on the earth. If things needed watered, God provided a mist. It had never rained. Does that help you understand when he starts building that ark? It had never rained. Those people are looking at him like, you are nuts, man, for real. And I am certain they said that to him. But Noah was obedient. Now, he told him how to build the ark, who would be in the ark with him, and what kind of food he was to bring. And in verse 22, it tells us, Noah did everything, not just the things he wanted to, not just the little things. Noah did everything just as God commanded him. Noah's history of obedience continues in Genesis chapter 7. In verse 1, the Lord then said to Noah, go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I have found you righteous in this generation. Would you like to hear those words from your God? I find you righteous in this generation. In verses 2 and 3, he tells him to bring. Now, here's another one, guys. This is really, really cool. Of the clean beasts, 7 pairs. Wait a minute. What happened to the pair? What happened to the pair? Ah, it gets better. Hold on. Of the not clean beast, 1 pair of each kind. For the birds of the air, 7 pairs. Here's your clue. They use the extra pair of clean beasts for food because the Lord provided for them. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I've read a lot about Noah. I don't ever remember reading about all the extra pairs. I don't know how I missed it. But that's a pretty glorious thing to think about. They still had the pairs left. Well, first of all, pairs to eat. Ha ha, that's a Darren joke. Pairs to eat, but also the pairs of each animal because they needed those animals to go forth and multiply when they came out of the ark. But God provided the food for them. Sorry, Greg, I'm blowing into it. God provided, just like he provides for each of us. We don't live in the days of Noah. We have it better than Noah did, guys. But God provides just like he did in the days of Noah. Verse 4, God tells Noah that in 7 days, it will rain for 40 days and 40 nights, and everything God created will be wiped off the face of the earth. And verse 5 tells us, and Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. At no point in the Bible do we read about any arguments. I'm not sure if the writer would have put them in if there were any. But we know that Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. In verses 6 through 15, Noah, his wife, his sons, and their wives, along with all the animals God told Noah to gather, entered the ark as God commanded them. And in verse 16, and this is probably one of my favorite parts, we are told the Lord shut them in and closed the door. Noah didn't close that door. His sons didn't close that door. God put them in that ark, and he closed that door to keep them safe. In verses 17 through 24, the flood came. Those people weren't laughing anymore. They weren't making fun of them anymore. Very, very sad time on the earth. It destroyed everything that was not in the ark, and the waters prevailed for 5 months. From Genesis chapter 8, verse 1, God remembered Noah, his family, and the animals, and the waters receded. From verses 2 through 4, waters diminished 150 days later. On the 17th day of the 7th month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat, which is in Armenia. The waters continued to diminish until the 10th month, and at the end of another 40 days, Noah opened the window of the ark. In verses 5 through 12, we're told that Noah sent out a raven, which went to and fro. And then he sent out a dove, but she returned because she had nowhere to land. He waited another 7 days, and he sent out another dove, and she came back in the evening with a freshly plucked olive leaf in her mouth. And he waited another 7 days and sent out another dove. She did not return. Verses 13 and 14 tell us by the first day of the first month of Noah's 601st year, the water had dried up from the earth, finally. Noah then removed the covering from the ark and saw that the surface of the ground was dry. By the 27th day of the second month, the earth was completely dry. In verses 15 through 20, God told Noah to go forth out of the ark. By the way, they had been in the ark 1 year and 10 days. Now listen, if you do your math and it doesn't jive, remember, God's timing is not my timing. They had been in that ark 1 year and 10 days, so they left the ark, took his family and all the animals, and what was the first thing he did? He immediately built an altar to the Lord. In all things first, we give glory to God. He offered the animals as burnt offering, and we read in verses 21 and 22, the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma and said in his heart, never again will I curse the ground because of humans, even though every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. Ladies and gentlemen, still today we live in a fallen world from way back in the beginning, but God says, never again will I destroy all living creatures as I have done. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. In Genesis chapter 9, verse 1, we're told that God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. And now we know, of course, why we had to have the male and the female of all the animals and why Noah and his wife were there as well as his sons and their wives. Now we do know that not long after the family left the ark, Noah did fall into some sin. But over the years, God has kept his promise. That rainbow in the sky. Remember the true meaning of that rainbow. In Genesis 9:11, God says, I will establish a covenant, my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. That is the true meaning of the rainbow. Noah's obedience brought blessing to his family and even still to us this many years later. Noah's blessings continue today, but they couldn't have happened if Noah had not obeyed God's instructions. I can't share Noah's story of obedience without sharing Abraham's story of obedience as well. You can turn to Genesis chapter 22. We learn that God told Abraham, he didn't ask him, he told him, you take your one and only son Isaac and offer him as a burnt offering. Hey, dads, how easy would that be for you? How easy would that be? Nowhere in the scripture does it share that Abraham did anything but obey. Throughout chapter 22, we see that Abraham went to the location in Moriah where God told him to go. He took Isaac, he split wood, he took his knife, and he went to the place he was directed. In verse 7, innocent Isaac says to his father Abraham, where is the lamb for the burnt sacrifice. And in verse 8, Abraham tells Isaac that God himself will provide for the burnt offering. And when they reached the place God had directed Abraham, he laid Isaac on the altar. And notice something else. In addition to Abraham obeying God, Isaac was obedient to his father. Can you imagine either one of them in that situation? As a mother, as a grandmother, it gives me shuddering thoughts to think that situation that Abraham was in. However, he did exactly what God commanded him to do. He reached for his knife. Let me ask you this. What hard thing is God asking you to do right now? Will you be able to do it and be obedient just like Abraham? You should think about that. Then in verses 11 and 12, the angel of the Lord stopped Abraham. He told Abraham that he knew that he feared and revered God, so he was not going to take his one and only son. Instead, in verse 13, we're told Abraham saw a ram caught in the thicket, and Abraham took the ram and used that as the sacrifice. And God told Abraham in verses 16 through 18, he said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of your enemies, and through your offspring all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. Abraham and his descendants, which, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, include us, were blessed. But first, Abraham had to show obedience to what God had asked him to do. Let's see what God asked of Joshua and his response. We heard a little bit from Joshua in Dana's message to the children. We're going to jump to chapter 6. Now the gates of Jericho were securely barred because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. In verses 2 through 14, God told Joshua that he was going to deliver Jericho into their hands, along with its king and their fighting men. Here were their instructions. March around the city once with all the armed men and do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. And on the 7th day, they were to march around the city 7 times, and the priests were to blow the trumpets. And when they blew with a loud blast on the trumpet, the whole army was to shout, a loud shout. Then the wall of the city would collapse, and the army could go in, and everybody could go in and take it over. And Joshua told the people God's instructions. Joshua reminded the army that no sound should be made by them until the day he told them to shout. Only the trumpets were to be heard. So the 7 priests carrying the trumpets were marching before the ark of the Lord and blowing the trumpets, and they did this for 6 days. 6 days they marched around the city. And from verses 15 through 27, on the 7th day they marched around the city 7 times. The 7th time around, when the priests sounded the trumpet, Joshua commanded the army to shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now God was very particular about what they could keep and what they should stay away from when they inhabited the city. He instructed them on all this, and they listened through Joshua to what the Lord instructed them to do. And when the trumpet sounded, the army shouted, and at the sound of the trumpet, when the man gave a loud shout, guess what? The walls collapsed, just like God promised, because they were obedient. They charged in, and they took the city. They devoted the city to the Lord and destroyed with the sword every living thing in it. However, Joshua had instructed the 2 men who had spied out the land to go and bring Rahab out and all those that lived with her, and they placed them in a safe place outside the camp of Israel. If you want to read more about the Rahab story, you can read that in Joshua chapter 2. Then, once they had Rahab and her family all out of the city, they burned the whole city. They put the silver and gold and articles of bronze and iron into the treasury of the Lord's house. And Rahab and her family were spared because she had hid the spies Joshua had previously sent to Jericho. And Joshua pronounced an oath as God had instructed him. And the Lord was with Joshua. God's power took the walls down, but first, the people had to be obedient to God's direction. And here's two examples from the New Testament from Luke 5, 1 through 7. One day as Jesus was standing by the Sea of Galilee, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to take the boat a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Uh-oh, Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. Here it goes, folks. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats, so full they began to sink. There's that obedience and blessing. And from Luke 5, verse 27, after this, Jesus went out and saw a tax collector by the name of Levi, whose Christian name was Matthew, sitting at his tax booth. "Follow me," Jesus said to him, and Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. Simon Peter and Levi, known to us as Matthew, they were disciples of Jesus, blessed beyond measure because they chose to obey God. Too many blessings to name in the time we have together, but we know that in the biggest part of their story in the scriptures I shared is their obedience. No argument. They listened, they did, and they were blessed by what was asked of them. Obedience brings blessing. An interesting thing, as I was preparing for this, I had one personal story that I wanted to share with you. It's gone. It's still in my heart. But God brought me another one. So back in 1988, Pastor Darren had been in the military for a number of years. He went in right after graduation in 1980. He knew that he was being called out of the military to go into the ministry. So when he shared that with me, I could see on his face that he was waiting to see the apprehension. I like my security, guys. We had a good life in the Navy. He was good at what he did. He provided for us very securely. Our little girls were happy, and we lived in a great neighborhood with wonderful people, and we were in an awesome church. But as soon as he started talking to me, I just had a complete peace fall over me. Then he had a conversation with our pastor at the time, and we were praying quite a bit, and we knew that this was what God was doing. So when it was time for him to reenlist in January of 1989, he did not reenlist. He got a job at a Methodist camp near our home in Jacksonville, Florida. He felt that he could work there while he was figuring out college and seminary. He was 2 weeks out of high school, guys, when he enlisted in the Navy. So, and you know and I know that in order to be an ordained pastor, you have to do the college and then the seminary. Well, he was just a baby when he went in the Navy, so he was going to have to take care of all that. 1 week after he started that job, 7 days, 1 week, the grant fell through, and there was no job. Through many prayers, he knew that God did not want him to do the easy thing and go back in the Navy. They would have welcomed him back. He was good at what he did. He was well-liked. But he knew that wasn't what God wanted him to do. So we continue to pray for guidance. I increased my babysitting jobs and my cleaning jobs, and he started doing odd jobs all over the place. It's amazing the amount of odd jobs that our neighbors and church people provided. Did they really need their garage painted? I doubt it. But we were taken care of. Each week, at the end of the week, we gathered our wages, tithed first, paid our bills, and we always made it. Our bills always got paid. No matter what we earned, our tithe came first, and we were just fine. Funny story, back then our girls loved Taco Bell. They have since discovered authentic Mexican, and I don't think they set foot in Taco Bell. But back then, they were little, they loved Taco Bell, and truly that was our splurge when we had a little extra. And we actually ended up many times over that 6 months of unemployment at Taco Bell. Silly to think about, but worth sharing, because God provided for us in that 6 months. We were faithful to the tithe in the church. We were faithful to put him first. we were obedient to the scriptures that say, give your first fruits, and God provided for us. After about 6 months, God provided a job for us at the group home in Grove City, Pennsylvania, and we ended up working for them for 13 years, partly in Pennsylvania, and then they moved us to Indiana, and Darren was able to attend college and seminary as we worked there. There's so much more that I could share with this story, but that's basically the summary that I want to remind you. Obedience brings blessings. So here's a few things I hope you'll take away from this message. Noah obeyed God and did exactly what God told him to do, and God blessed him and protected him. Noah's God is our God, the same yesterday, today, and forever. And what he did for Noah, he will do for us. He's not going to ask you to build an ark, guys, because he's never going to flood the earth like that again. But there may be something much smaller that he's going to ask you to do, and I hope you'll be obedient. You, me, we are the very blessing that came from Abraham's obedience. And our obedience in situations could change nations and generations as well. Have you considered how powerful obedience is? From Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. God will take care of you when you obey him. Psalm 128, verses 1 and 2. Blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in obedience to him. You will eat the fruit of your labor. Blessings and prosperity will be yours. Peace and prosperity are just a few of the blessings that are promised when you obey the Lord. From Job 36, 11. If they obey and serve him, they will spend the rest of their days in prosperity and their years in contentment or peace. Obedience flows from a place of love. When we are in love with God, we will desire to obey him. God did not give us his word to restrict us. He gave it to us to protect us. It will be hard to obey God if we do not know what his word says. So please read his word and show your willingness to follow his directions and watch his blessings pour out. What is God telling you to do? What is God asking you to do? What do you feel led to do? Is there a committee to serve on? Is there something you want to help with and you're like, That is probably God nudging you, and I wouldn't ignore him because he's not going to go away. Are you resisting his will, or will you be obedient? Rachel, how long was it before you knew God was wanting you to write that book? Did you resist him at all, or were you right there ready to go? And you obeyed, and look at the blessing that's coming out of it and how we will all be blessed by your writings. Thank you for listening to him. One final thing. Back in May 2018, if any of you watched The Chosen, the actor that plays Jesus, I can't pronounce his name. I know his first name is Jonathan. I can't pronounce his last name. I'm not going to botch that because I've done that enough with names of children in school. Goodness gracious. But he had been living in L.A. for 8 years. He was nearly broke, had enough food for only one more day, and no work in sight. He got on his knees. He poured out his heart to God. He completely surrendered his career to God. He literally prayed, I surrender. I surrender. He wanted to do what God wanted him to do. Later that day, not next week, not next month, not next year, later that day, he found 4 checks in the mail. 3 months later, he was cast for the role of Jesus in The Chosen. Obedience brings blessing. Let us pray. Lord, into your hands we commit ourselves. Help us to have ears to listen and minds to be obedient to what you have called us to do. We pray we will always remember that obedience brings blessings. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please rise.
From Numbers chapter 26, verses 24 through 26. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Have a blessed week. Amen and amen.
So I throw up my hands.